In this video, we talk about popular, rule-based portfolio strategies. Now, the ones that we look at are the market weight portfolio, diversity weight portfolio, equal weight portfolio, risk parity portfolio, minimum variance portfolio, equal risk contribution portfolio, Kelly rule portfolio, and the proportional to Sharpe ratio portfolio. So you learn in this video that these rules are all special mean variance portfolios. And maybe surprisingly, these portfolios do often outperform mean variance optimal portfolios. Now, this video here explains you why that is the case. So let's talk about these special mean variance portfolios. And let me give you a quick and punchy definition of each of these portfolio rules. Often the name already suggests what they do. So let's start. The market weight portfolio mimics the relative market capitalization of each asset within the investor's investment opportunity set. The diversity weight portfolio applies a specific power transformation to the market weights. The precise form of the transformation and an empirical assessment of its success is contained in Fernholz, Garvey, and Hannon, 1998. Now, the equal weight portfolio is also known as the 1 over N rule. Dutchin and Levy, 2009, among many others, call it also the Talmudic rule. The reason is that the Babylonian Talmud has already recommended that investment strategies 1,000 years ago. Now, it said that a man should always place his money, 1/3 in land, 1/3 in merchandise, and keep 1/3 in hand. Now let's move on to the really popular risk parity portfolio. There are two variations of risk parity. There's risk parity variance and risk parity volatility. A risk parity portfolio chooses weights proportional to the inverse of either variance or volatility. That concept was introduced by Qian in 2005. Bridgewater Associates, a large hedge fund, was the first firm to launch an investment fund in 1996 that allocated investments according to the risk parity rule. That fund was named All Weather Fund. Originally, this rule is implemented in terms of variance, but several funds prefer to work in volatility space. If you're interested, you could read Martellini 2008 and Schifati and Coignard 2008 to get further insights. Now, another popular strategy is the minimum variance portfolio. And that is basically the global minimum variance portfolio, so the leftmost point on the mean variance efficient frontier. The equal risk contribution portfolio constructs weights such that each asset contributes equally to the total portfolio variance. In case you're interested, you could read Qian 2008 or Maillard, Roncanelli, and Tailech 2010. Now let's come to the Kelly rule. The Kelly rule builds portfolio weights such that the portfolio's expected log return is maximized. And finally, the proportional to Sharpe ratio portfolio invests relative to the realized 5-year Sharpe ratios of each asset class in the portfolio. Now, looking at all these different portfolios, a natural question pops up. How do these rule-based portfolio strategies perform relative to a mean variance optimal portfolio? My former colleague from Columbia Business School, Dr. Andrew Ng, provides in his asset management textbook a nice horse race. I refer to the 2014 edition. There he compares these portfolio rules using 4 asset classes: Barcap US Treasuries, Barcap US Credit, the S&P 500, and the MSCI EAFE. The data is sampled monthly, and the performance is tracked from January 1978 to December 2011. A strategy that is implemented at time T relies on data over the past 5 years. So any estimation relies on the previous 60 data points. Portfolios are held for 1 month and new portfolios are formed at the end of each month. The 1 month T-bill is used as the risk-free rate. And shorting a specific asset class is restricted to -100%. Now, the findings of that horse race are as follows. First, any form of diversified portfolios has produced a higher Sharpe ratio than a 100 investment in US equities only. Now, let's take the Sharpe ratio of the S&P 500 investment as the baseline case. And its Sharpe ratio in the sample was 0.35. Now, the second finding was that the unconstrained mean variance optimal portfolio underperforms massively. Its realized Sharpe ratio was a shockingly 0.07. Maybe even worse, any other portfolio rule performed better. The third finding was the completely passive strategy of market weights earned a Sharpe ratio of 0.41. And fourth, diversity weights tilted the portfolio more towards small cap firms and earned a Sharpe ratio of 0.46. Now, the fifth takeaway was that the equal weight portfolio performed well, earning a Sharpe ratio of 0.54. Now, research by De Miguel, Garlappi and Upal in 2009 find that the equal weight portfolio outperforms a variety of portfolios. Now, the sixth takeaway was that risk parity performed even better than the equal weight portfolio. So, risk parity in terms of variance earned a Sharpe ratio of 0.59. Risk parity based on volatility earned a Sharpe ratio of 0.65. It's useful to note that Andrew Ng writes that applying risk parity to more than four asset classes has in the past produced Sharpe ratios of more than 1.0. Now, the seventh takeaway for me was that the minimum variance portfolio earned a Sharpe ratio of 0.52. It actually has dominated the market because over the past decades, low volatility stocks outperformed high volatility stocks. Now, let's better understand why the so-called optimal mean variance portfolio is anything but optimal in real-life applications. So, we now want to go towards understanding the reasons for why Markowitz optimal portfolios underperform in real-life applications. So, notice, mean variance optimal portfolios are essentially a nonlinear transformation of the investment opportunity set, which, as we talked about previously, consists of expected asset returns, asset volatility, and pairwise correlations. The biggest risk factor for a mean variance optimal asset allocation is that an investor has to estimate many of these parameters. So the garbage in and garbage out problem that we also talked about in another video becomes a severe problem as minor estimation errors in inputs blow up to large output errors. Now, having n assets means one has to estimate n expected returns and n times n plus 1 over 2 elements in a covariance matrix. Now, if you have a portfolio with 5,000 stocks, which is roughly the number of listed US stocks, you have to estimate more than 12,000 parameters. So good luck with that. That won't work, basically. And that's what the horse race shows. Now let's dig a bit deeper into the different strategies to identify why they are simply special mean variance portfolios and why that special feature made them outperform the, in theory, optimal mean variance portfolio. So we start with the minimum variance portfolio. Such a portfolio does not rely on estimates for expected returns. One could say that such portfolios are optimal mean variance portfolios under the assumption that all assets under consideration share the same expected return. From that, we deduct that the devastating underperformance of the unconstrained mean variance optimal portfolio must be due to measurement errors in the estimates for each asset's expected return. Now we look at the risk parity portfolio. That portfolio does not estimate expected returns and does also not estimate pairwise correlations. One could say it assumes these quantities to be the same across all assets. Now, having learned that the risk parity portfolio outperformed the minimum variance portfolio, suggests that the reason for that are measurement errors in the correlation estimates, which affect the minimum variance portfolio. If you look at the equal weight portfolio, you realize that that portfolio doesn't require a single parameter estimate. So through the lenses of a Markowitz portfolio optimizer, one could say that all assets are kind of identical. The market weight portfolio is even cheaper to trade as the equal weight portfolio, as it doesn't require any form of rebalancing. So if one was to consider transaction costs in that strategy, then I would suppose that that portfolio would even outperform several of the other strategies. Now, in one sentence, I really love that horse race from the Eng book. It is plain and simple and highlights that strategies that rely on a few estimation inputs perform better than complex models that are theoretically optimal on the one hand, but which require a large amount of estimates as inputs. Already Merton in 1980 showed that estimating means is a very tricky business and that using high-frequency data doesn't help. Long-run means need to be estimated with very long samples. So the minimum variance portfolio outperforms the mean variance portfolio because the former is not subject to estimation errors in mean returns. In addition, volatilities are rather easy to estimate, especially if you have access to high-frequency data. High-frequency data does also help to pin down correlations, but correlations can switch sign and are therefore also more difficult to estimate than volatilities. For example, Green and Holyfield, 1992, show that small correlation errors can lead to large swings in portfolio weights. Hence, it's clear why strategies such as risk parity outperform the minimum variance strategy. The latter is fooled by noise in correlation estimates. Now, let's conclude that video with a final advice. Now, my final note of advice would be as follows. If you can handle rebalancing costs, start off with an equal weight portfolio. Research shows that this portfolio is hard to beat. One would also expect such a portfolio to outperform a market weight portfolio. Now, if you have skills in estimating variances or volatilities, then try out whether a risk parity portfolio dominates the equal weight baseline portfolio. In addition, if you feel confident being able to correctly predict correlations, check out whether you overperform with the minimum variance portfolio. Now, do only work with an unconstrained mean variance optimal portfolio if you have strong skills in predicting mean returns on top of correlations and volatilities, or if you simply want to lose money. Now, this also explains why you see in industry constrained Markowitz optimal portfolios. In short, no one trusts the output of unconstrained Markowitz portfolios, especially if the asset universe is sufficiently large. Now, last not least, common to all popular portfolio strategies is the observation that they all achieve a high degree of diversification. And therefore, diversification rocks.